We were saying last week that there is an image most of us have about the Holy Spirit. Well, actually, we break it down into the Godhead. Many of us look at the Father, and the first thing we think of is Creator, one, the big cheese, if you will, one that's in charge, one that is calling the shots. And then when you think of the Son, you think of Redeemer, you think of the one that came and the one that the Son, God coming in the flesh and dwelling among us. And you have the picture in your mind of the Son. But then when we get into the Holy Spirit, sometimes we don't have the right image. We think of just the word Spirit being a mist. We don't put to the Spirit a person or a personality in certain the traits that would make him real and relational. And so our study is trying to do that. We're actually studying pneumatology, which is the study of the person and the work of the Holy Spirit. Pneuma meaning spirit or breath, tology meaning study of, science of. So we are studying, doing the study of the Holy Spirit. I'd like us to start tonight by doing a little look back on the last thing that we said last week as we closed out that particular class. And we said it this way in letter E of your notes from last week. We asked the question, why is the doctrine of the Holy Spirit important? Why even study the Holy Spirit? Why do we need to know more about the Holy Spirit? I mean, if I'm God, I take God in this relationship, I have a relationship with God, isn't that good enough that I have this relationship and that I know God and that I'm saved by receiving Jesus in my heart and making him the Lord of my life? Isn't that enough? What is this? Why do I have to take it this step further? Well, we said a statement in our teaching that I think could help us lead to where we want to go tonight as we talk about the Spirit is God. We said this, that it can be said that your understanding of God the Father and Jesus as Savior is related to your understanding and relationship of the Holy Spirit. That's powerful. Again, your understanding of God the Father and Jesus as Savior is related to your understanding and relationship to the Holy Spirit. If we do not know the Holy Spirit, if we do not have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, then we are missing out on the full relationship that God would have for us, that we could have in God through Jesus. We're missing out on that. So we need to know who the Holy Spirit is and recognize him as part of the Godhead, just like we see God the Father and God the Son as part of the Godhead. We said this about our relationship with the Holy Spirit. Just like Jesus had a relationship with his disciples, to that degree, we should have that kind of relationship with the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus said, I must leave you so that he, the Holy Spirit, can come in my place. And if Jesus had a relationship with man, to the degree that when a man had a need, he'd go to Jesus and Jesus would meet that need, it shows you the kind of relationship we could have with the Holy Spirit today. That we come to the Holy Spirit the same way the disciples came to Jesus. When they had a financial need, they went to him and he told them to go fish. And sure enough, in the belly of that fish was a coin. If we have a financial need, then we come to the Holy Spirit and we ask him to meet the need. If we have a physical need, as they did in the time of Jesus, when there was one that was sick and they would go to Jesus for healing, the same could be said of us, that we could go to the Holy Spirit and seek healing. So knowing the Holy Spirit opens us up to God and Jesus even more. We said a couple of things about that. We said this, if we think of the Holy Spirit as an abstract or impersonal influence or power, we are robbing a divine person of the worship, love, and recognition he deserves. If we don't recognize the Spirit of God as being that God to us, that influence of God, then we are withholding worship to the deity of God in our life. We said if he is merely an influence or power, if he is merely an influence or power, our perspective will be from the standpoint of how we can access and use that power. If he is a divine person, then our perspective becomes more from the standpoint of how he can use us. This brings humility instead of self-exhortation, meaning if all we see him as is a power source that we can run into and plug our power cord into, then we really use him for what we want or what we need. We use him. On the other side of that, if he is a divine person, then we're more concerned about how he can use us rather than how we can use him. If he's God to us, then we seek his direction, then we seek his will for our lives, how he can use us. And then we said, lastly, knowing that a person of the Godhead is indwelling you leads to the communion with the Holy Spirit, as even Paul describes in 2 Corinthians. And that's beautiful to know that we could have communion. And that word communion means common union. We can have communion with God through communion with the Holy Spirit. If you were reading along with us, you would have read in your book this week, chapter 3. And it was talking about the Holy Spirit in the history of Israel. And I don't usually read so much, but I know that there are students in the class that, let me back up. I don't usually take time in the class to read the book. But I know that not all of our students read the book either. And I don't want you to miss out on some of the beautiful things that the book says. And being that some of you aren't reading the book along with you, I'm going to do a little reading time for a minute. Give me a minute. You'll notice you only have one page of notes. There's two reasons for that. The biggest reason is you have how many pages?
Three pages.
Wait a minute. Wait.
That's 3 pages. Is that the old notes?
No. No, you're cool. My bad. The answers is just one page. That's the guy that's in the back there. Oh, I didn't think I gave you that many. Did we change the font? Did we change the font size? The head of the school chose to put the... No, that's cool. You got scriptures on there, so that'll help you. Okay. Well, back to my comment. I was saying you don't have a lot of notes. That's because we're going to have time. It's a lot of detail stuff, just boom, 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 and I don't want to get caught up in that. But I want you to hear something, because what I found so interesting from the get-go out of the teaching is that when we look at God's introduction of the Holy Spirit, we really don't see him fully manifested until the New Testament. But that doesn't mean that he wasn't on the scene. He was there every step of the way. And you see the way in our teaching or in our reading, you would have read the way that he deals with Israel at the onset. So let me read you something, because it just sounds like us today. It really does. So bear with me as I read for a little bit here, okay? As we come into the historical books, this is page 33 if you'd like to read along in your copy. As we come into the historical books, there is no specific mention of the Holy Spirit until we get to the book of Judges. Though Joshua was Spirit-filled, there was a quiet presence in his life rather than notable outward manifestations. At times, however, it seems he fell back into trusting in his own judgment instead of seeking the guidance of guidance the Spirit of God could give. Remember, even last week, I kind of felt like as I read this, I fell into that same category, that doing church and doing life and doing all that we do, sometimes I feel like it's up to me and I forget that I have this great helper that wants to help us along the way. But these were the exceptions. On the whole, Joshua obeyed the Lord. saw God fulfill many promises and left Israel with a challenge to serve the Lord and Him alone. All went well as long as Joshua lived and as long as the elders lived who had crossed the Jordan and had seen the glory and power of God. In three great campaigns, Joshua subdued the land so that the land had rest from war. Then he proceeded to divide the land among the tribes. All the Canaanite cities had not been conquered, however, nor did the Israelites follow God's command to drive them out. Listen to this. Actually, each tribe was given the task of completing the conquest of its own territory. As the Lord reminded Joshua, there was still much land to be possessed. The individual tribes also failed to obey the Lord in this. Again and again, the book of Judges repeats that the various tribes did not drive out the Canaanites. Some cities they were not able to conquer, but the Canaanites they conquered were put to work chopping wood or bringing in water from the wells. As Israel became stronger, they could have driven them out, but they preferred to take money from them as tribute. Only on a few occasions did they step out in faith and see God's power manifested again. Most of the time, they were quite content to settle back and enjoy the fruit of their new prosperity. Unfortunately, the Israelites had never learned how to handle prosperity. With this increased prosperity came spiritual decline. The older generation was so taken up with their own pleasures that worship became formal. The training of the young was either neglected or the bad example of the parents made their words meaningless. As a result, a new generation arose who knew neither the Lord nor what He had done for Israel. This does not mean these young people had never heard about the Lord or the miracles. They knew about the deliverance from Egypt. Undoubtedly, they had heard the story of the fall of Jericho again and again, but the word new means more than knew about. The tragic fact is that though they had heard of these things, they did not know the Lord for themselves. They had never seen any of His miracle working power in their own experience. As a result, the young generation were attracted to the feasting, drunkenness, and lax morals of the Canaanite culture, as well as to the prestige of their ancient temples and high places. When this happened, God withdrew His blessings and sent armies to bring His judgment on the various tribes. These enemies were the very Canaanites whose religion and immorality they had followed. Again and again, this happened throughout the period of the judges. Though the tribes of Israel had an established leadership in the elders and priests, they were of little help. In fact, they too were influenced by Canaanite ways all too often. A comparison of Judges shows that the 40 years of Eli's priesthood in Shiloh overlapped the judgeship of Jephthah in Gilead and Samson in Dan. Thus, it seems evident that the permissiveness and heathen influence that characterized Eli and his sons were all too common during the whole period. It was a time when everyone did as he saw fit, as Judges twice declares. Doesn't that sound more and more like the day we're living in today? That we have become a culture where everybody just believes whatever truth they choose to wrap their faith around or their belief around, that there are no longer any absolutes, that the prosperity of the people that once When we get into that prosperity, we're believing God for that prosperity. But once we get that prosperity, it seems to be that humanity loses grasp on God because it seems they look more at the prosperity that's in their hands. Doesn't that sound like where we're at today? Let me read this last chapter. God's chosen judges. Even the ones God chose to help and deliver the people during this time were not entirely free from its failings. And this is what gives us good news. But the Spirit of God worked, sometimes in spite of them. In fact, it seems God chose people who were unimportant and not well known, so that it could be seen that the power was of God and not of man. It seems God often chooses to use the lowly and the despised as his agents to bring deliverance and spiritual restoration, the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, so that no one may boast before him. When these men and women were aroused, moved, and filled by the Spirit of the Lord, they turned the hearts of the people to God, led them to victory, and inspired them to serve the Lord. And that's what I pray is happening as you and I get more and more of an understanding of who the Spirit of the Lord is, who the Holy Spirit is. That He will come upon us even in our weakness, even in our frailties. And when we understand the relationship we can have with God through His Holy Spirit, then we find ourselves empowered, able to be used by God to radically affect the world that we are living in. Not just try to get a blessing in our lives, but really be movers and shakers so that God could use us. So tonight, let's look at the Spirit as God. The Holy Spirit being God. We've learned that the Holy Spirit is not a vague, ethereal force. He's not this impersonal or unthinking being. He is a person, equal in every way with God, God the Father, God the Son. And what we'll see in this study is how the Bible shows us that the characteristics of God apparent in the Father and in the Son are equally apparent in the Holy Spirit, and that's because He is God. So let's get to our study. Lesson 2, the Spirit is God. Letter A there in our study is the Holy Spirit is synonymously referred to as God. The scripture verse that we want to look at there is Acts chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. And this will be one of those scripture verses I would remember when it comes to the fourth study of our class when we have our first test, okay? Because this is important. You need to know this as it relates to the Holy Spirit being God. Read it with me. Ready, everybody? 1, 2, 3. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received from the land? You have not lied to men, but to God. You know the story? This is the New Testament church that's getting on its legs. Acts chapter 5, five chapters in to the Pentecost experience where the church has come together. They are taking of what they have in excess and they're bringing it and they're laying it down at the apostles' feet. And then those who had need would come and take whatever they had need of as this pile was assembled. So this koinonia or fellowship, brotherly fellowship, was being established with the church. If you had a need, you knew where to go to get the need met. If you had abundance, you would come and bring your abundance there because you believe that God blessed you to the degree so that in turn you could be a blessing to others. Ananias and Sapphira somehow got it within them after they sold a piece of property that they can withhold a portion of that, keep it for themselves, put it in savings, hold it for a rainy day. Store it up for themselves instead of bringing it and laying it down at the disciples' feet. The Spirit of the Lord informed Peter that this was taking place. Nobody had to tell him, but the Spirit of the Lord brought this to him, his remembrance, or brought this to his awareness. So he calls in both of them, Ananias first and then Sapphira, and he brings them in and he asks them a simple question. What happened? And they had a chance to come clean, but they continued to lie. So the point here was this. When they had lied, they said in the scripture verse here that they lied to who? To the Holy Spirit. They lied to the Holy Spirit first. It says there, Satan so filled your heart that you've lied to the Holy Spirit. But then he comes down and he ends it saying, you have not lied to men, but to God. Notice that the Holy Spirit and God is synonymous. They're the same, one in the same. Also we see letter B. His name is coupled with that of God. Coupled in the sense of his first, his divine activities. The way in which he divinely works with man. We see in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 and 6. Now there are diverse gifts, but the same Spirit. And here it is. It is the same God that works it all. So the Holy Spirit and God is seen as the same. His name as Holy Spirit and the name of God being the same as it works in divine activities. We also see that with the baptismal formula. When we go to baptize individuals in water, we use the formula of Matthew chapter 28. We see it here in verses 19 and 20. And it says it this way. When we baptize them in the name of, here it is, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit's name is coupled with the name of God. And then there is the apostolic benediction. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14, again, the benediction that's given. Notice how the name of God is used with Jesus and the Holy Spirit coupled together. It says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. So when you see the Holy Spirit's name, you also see that his name is used with God and with Jesus being the Son. So he has just as much influence, just as much deity, just as much authority, just as much power as God the Father and God the Son, because he's part of the Trinity. Letter C, we're looking at divine attributes that are ascribed to the Holy Spirit. Divine attributes, and the attributes of God are actually his very nature, the aspects of God that actually make God who he is. And we have many attributes of God that we have looked over before in other classes, but just a few of them here are used. Those very same attributes are used as they're seen in the person of the Holy Spirit. The first would be omniscience. Omniscience or omniscience. What does omniscience mean? Anyone know? Omniscience. It is the what attribute of God? All-knowing. He knows all things. All things are in him. He knows all things. All things originate from him. He knows all things. He's all-knowing. So the omniscience of God. The scripture distinctly says that the Spirit searches all and knows all, even to the deep things of God. And the scripture verse that we want to look at is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 10 and 11. It says, but as God has revealed it to us by his Spirit, the Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the man's spirit within him. In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Again, John 14, 26, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said. So if I don't recognize the Holy Spirit as being just as influential in the Godhead as God the Father and God the Son is, then I'm missing out on certain things I need to know about life because I can't tap into the all-knowing one. But he's all-knowing. And so when I need direction, I can go to the Holy Spirit in my prayer. I can have this image of him that we have, that I serve him as God because he knows all things. So the thought here is this: if the Spirit teaches all, then the Spirit knows all. Another attribute of the Spirit is omnipotence. Omnipotent. And what does that mean? He is what? All powerful. Potent. Potent meaning powerful. So he is all powerful. We know God is all powerful, but now we need to see that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is all powerful. Here in Luke 1, 35, the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you," speaking of Mary, "and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." There it is, the power of the Most High. As the Spirit comes on you, the all power that the Most High has, that same power will come upon you. Romans 15, 19, "By the power of signs and miracles, through the power of the Spirit, so from Jerusalem all the way around Lycaonium, I have fully proclaimed the gospel of Christ." The power of the Holy Spirit. Again, I need to recognize that I'm never in a jam. I'm never really in a jam that the power of God can't get me out of, because here Jesus has given us that power source to now be available for us in this world. The power source of God is the Holy Spirit. He's all powerful. He's also omnipresent. The omnipresence of God. What does the omnipresence of God mean? He's present everywhere. The omnipresence of God means that he is present everywhere. And we take that of the Spirit. He's present everywhere. Now, was Jesus in his physical form omnipresent? No. Why? Because he was only one man. That meant he can only be in one place at one time. But he says on his way out that the Spirit would come and he would be with us as our comforter, our counselor. So the good news is when we all go home tonight, the Holy Spirit goes with each and every one of us. He is present everywhere. So we're really never alone. We're never really powerless. Because he's all powerful. And he's always with us. Does the Holy Spirit have the power? Or excuse me, do I have the power to walk out of all of my addictions? As long as I'm tapped into the Holy Spirit, I do. Because I'm never alone. As long as I have that. I asked Jeff, because Jeff and Gloria head up our Project Life, which is part of our recovery ministry. Yes, I have that ability. Why? Because the Spirit is all powerful and he's with me at all times. He's present everywhere. So Psalm 139, and this is huge, 7 through 10. David says, "Where can I go from your Spirit?" Now listen to what he says. "Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to heavens, you are there. And if I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast." We asked this question in one of the classes early on. We said, is God in hell? David says, if I make my bed in, one scripture verse says, Sheol, hell, you are there. Think of that. God is everywhere. There's no place we could go without his presence. And the Spirit of God is present everywhere. Other scripture verse you can look at, Isaiah 66 and Jeremiah 23. And then number four would be the eternality of God. And whereas present everywhere, or omnipresence means present everywhere, eternality of God means he's ever present. Ever present. Time has past, present, and future. And what we've learned about eternity is it's timeless. In the past, we drew this example. We said this. This is time. This is time. And time is controlled by seconds. Right? Remember that? Time's controlled by seconds. And the past, there's the past. As soon as a new second ticks, we're in the future. I mean, in the present, there's the present. But there was... time's always moving. You have a past, you have a present, and you have a future. But when we start looking at God, if this is time... In God, well, just take the whole board. The whole board would be eternity. Because eternity is just there. It's timelessness. There's none of this. There's no past. There's no presence. There's no existence of time in eternity. It's just, if you try to say that God had a beginning, then he cannot be eternal. We can't say that God had a beginning. Because when there was a beginning, God was already there. So in the beginning, God was already there. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. When there was a yesterday, God was already there. That's why it's just his eternality. He's eternal. That's why it says he does not change. Because he's eternal. We've talked in other classes about, you know, God knowing the future. And if God knows the future, then that means that God has organized and planned and ordered everything. And in talking about that, when we look at it from that perspective, some people want to say, well, then, you know, why even try? God knows who's going to go to heaven and who's going to go to hell. And the fact that God may know that does not mean that God's the one that's telling or choosing who's going to go where. Just because he knows it doesn't mean that he's chosen it. It's like us that like to watch a football game or a sporting event. We tape it on our DVR at home. And got a couple of guys here that like to box back there. You know, if I get my HBO specials and my show box, and I go back and watch all my show boxing. But if it's a real good fight, you know, I'm going to go ahead and find out who won first. I'm going to go on ESPN and I'm going to find out, okay, did Pacquiao win that fight or what? I just want to know before I watch it. So I know the end, but I don't know everything that happens during the end. So I go back and I start watching it. I go back to the beginning and I hit play and I watch round by round by round by round because I want to get into the excitement of what happened, who was really suffering, who was really, you know, fighting, who was doing on their game, who was out of it. I go back and watch it, and that's kind of like life. God knows who wins, and we've all win. You know, those in Christ, we win. God knows, but it's not as though he's the one that's in the round, in the fight, trying to hurt us, trying to help us, doing the punching or fighting for us. He said, no, you guys can do that. I've given you a power source to do that. You could overcome. And God's sitting back there and is like, yeah, man, everything's right there. God sees it all. Why? He's already been to the beginning. He's already been to the end. Why? Because God is eternal. He doesn't have a start date and he doesn't have an expiration date. He's eternal. Yes. This room is eternity. That's time. In God's eyes, that's time. And this room is eternal. It's the bigness of God. Yes. And we don't think he can help us meet our needs and take care of our lives. And well, when you understand that, you also see that is true of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is an ever-abiding presence. He didn't just get his start on the day of Pentecost. He was forever. He was there with God, eternal. And here it is. How much more? Hebrews 9:14. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God. There it is, the eternal Spirit. He's been for eternity. He's been here since eternity. Eternity being forever. Biblical proofs of the divine or to the divine attributes being ascribed to the Holy Spirit here also prove that he is God. So he's not a little God. He's God. He's up there with God the Father, God the Son. What are some of the names, divine names, letter D, that are given to him? We know the Father and Son have certain names ascribed to them, setting forth their nature and work. Likewise, it is true of the Holy Spirit. He has names that indicate his character and his work. Number one would be the Holy Spirit. We see them that in Luke 11:13. If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Divine names. He's the Holy Spirit. He's also the Spirit of God. Genesis 1:2. Now the earth was formless and void. Formless and void and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. If you've read in your book, and I hope you are still reading, if you've read in your book, you would have seen in chapter 2, I believe it is, some of the things about that right there on the hovering Spirit, how powerful that is. But he's known as the Spirit of God. There he was. Notice at creation, the Spirit of God was present, the Holy Spirit. Then we see number three, the Spirit of life. We see that in Romans chapter 8, verse 2. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. The Spirit of life. Here the Spirit introduces us to the realm of eternal life, and he is the dynamic in the believer's experience that leads him into life, liberty and power, because he's the Spirit of life. And if the Spirit of life can set us free, it's true freedom that we experience. But he's known as that Spirit of life. Why is this important? Why do I need to know these divine names and these attributes? Because I need to recognize that as I'm thinking of God, as I'm praying, as I'm building my relationship with God, my agent here on the earth of the Godhead that I should be communing with and having relation with and should be sensitive to is the person of the Holy Spirit. When they say that God is with us, it's his presence, it's his Spirit that is with us. And so I need to recognize him because he's usually the third person of the Trinity that is overlooked and forgotten. So I'm building my relationship by knowing these truths. He's also known as the Spirit of truth. Jesus says in John 14, and I will ask the Father, and he'll give you another counselor to be with you forever. Who will be this counselor? The Spirit of truth. John 16, 13, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he'll guide you into all truth. Funny story. In our house, there's a lot of music. Our girls, they got guitars for Christmas a couple years ago, and one of them got a new guitar this year for Christmas because she's really good, and she really wants to use her gift a little bit more around church, and so we made a little bit more of an investment to get her a nicer guitar. So they're always playing guitars. They're always singing. There's always music going on. I mean, you get in a car, they're singing. Everywhere, it's just music, music. Well, it was like that from the get-go, and our son Chris would always start to sing certain songs. So there was a song that was once sung, and it was talking about the Spirit of truth. And so Mary and I are listening to him one time sing in the back seat, and he's singing this song, and when we get to that part, he says, Spirit of Sooth, honey, the fear. And we looked at each other, Spirit of Sooth. We say, Chris, what did you just sing? What's the name of that? What's the words of that song? And he goes into it telling us all, and he gets to that part, Spirit of Soothe, you know. I said, no, son, no. It's Spirit of Truth. It's Spirit of Truth, but that's close. But the more I thought about that, I thought, man, that's exactly what he is. He's the Spirit of Soothe, too, man. When you need some help and you're going through a hard time and you're feeling all beat up, it's all right. Just call him the Spirit of Soothe as well. Well, when it comes to the Spirit of Truth, we understand he possesses the truth, which means he can reveal the truth, which means he'll lead us into truth. That's the place we need to be, is in truth. We can't be deceived. We can't be self-deceived. If there's something that's really tripping up society today, it's this whole self-deception. People are wrong and they don't even know they're wrong. Well, that's terrible to be lost. It really is. It's like, you know, my address is 16435 Southwest 88th Avenue. I live on 88th Avenue. Some people mistake that for 88th Street. Now, if you get the just that part of the address wrong, 88th Avenue or 88th Street, you are way off base. Because you'll be out in West Kendall on 164th Street, almost to Chrome Avenue. And I live down in Palmetto Bay, almost going south, you know, getting down south, Perrine. That's a big difference. So you could make a real mistake not knowing the truth, not noting, for my sake, not knowing whether it's the street or the avenue. That in itself makes a big difference. And there's people running around in life that are missing it just by one word, one truth. They're missing it, and they're lost. They're missing out on the good things that God has for them. You ever meet somebody that thinks they know everything? This is yes, this is no, right? You ever meet somebody that thinks they know everything? And every time you talk to them, it's like, why do I even have this conversation with you? You already know it all. You know? You know it all, so why do I have to come to you and talk to you? You know, okay, figure it out. Truth is, know-it-alls really don't know it all. They just don't know it all. So we have to recognize that that is true. And what we don't know is hurting us. Our lives are really the culmination of everything that our philosophy, everything that we have chosen to be, our philosophy in life, our lives are the result of that. If you're not happy with where you're at, then you need to add new knowledge to it. And you need to make sure that that knowledge is truth. You can't build your life on a lie. And knowing the truth, it says from that standpoint, knowing the truth will set you free. But I can't know the truth unless I engage the person of the Holy Spirit who knows all truth. And he says in the word that he'll reveal or lead me into all truth. What happens when I'm just trying to do life by myself without checking into what he has to say about my life? I'm missing out on the truth of that. I'm missing out on facts about me. And I don't want to be self-deceived. I don't want you to be self-deceived. It's a great deception. And we don't even need the devil to jack us up there. We don't need the devil to deceive us when we're self-deceived. The Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit, wants to come and be the truth to us. I really admire people who say, you know, lead me, Spirit of God. God, I don't know it all. Just show me, tell me, what is it? What is it that I need? He's also, number five, the Spirit of Promise. You'll like this too. Ephesians 1:13, you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal. The promised Holy Spirit. And you understand what a seal is there. In the King James, it says the Holy Spirit of promise. You understand what a seal is. A seal is, it could be almost a lock. Back in trucking, if a trucker is going to deliver a load somewhere, he packs up that load over here, some, you know, could be down south, some vegetables. Once he loads up his truck and they mark off what it is those trucks are going to be delivering, they then close the truck and they put a seal on that thing. And that seal will not be opened except by the person that's going to open the seal or get the delivery of the package. Years ago, we used to sell Christmas trees. They'd pile those Christmas trees in snow in those semis. And the first thing I'd have to look at when they'd come to deliver them is, do they have a seal on them? Because we had to count those trees because we're paying for those trees. And we wanted to make sure we got everything that we paid for. So you'd go to that seal and you'd check to make sure nobody messed or tinkered with that seal. You're the one, as the owner of it, that broke the seal. And then you'd be able to take out what is yours. And you knew, okay, I paid for this. I count it. It's mine. Delivery's been made. And that's what the Holy Spirit is. God has a delivery, and it's you. And every promise that God wants to get to you comes sealed by the Holy Spirit. And that seal's not broken. The enemy tries to get in there and cut it and steal and take from it. But no, no, no. You don't accept what doesn't have the seal of the Spirit on it because it's not your delivery. Just like you don't accept a harvest that you didn't sow towards. Don't accept a harvest that you didn't sow seed towards. Don't you accept a delivery that the Spirit of God doesn't have his seal on. It'll be good. It'll be perfect. It'll be uplifting. It'll be inspiring. It'll build you. That's why you got to be careful with every prophetic word somebody wants to try to speak over you. Because a prophetic word that somebody's going to speak over you is going to uplift you. It's going to point you in the right direction. The Spirit of God will convict. You don't need somebody coming up on top of you and trying to condemn you. The Spirit of God. The Spirit of truth. He's a Spirit of promise. And you're able to see that receiving of the Spirit is the fulfillment of Christ's promise even to you. When Christ says that he wants to send a comforter to you, that in itself is the receiving of the Spirit of the fulfillment of Christ's promise. So Galatians 3:14 talks about that. Joel 2:28 and so on. Other scripture verses we put there for you. Then number six, he's the Spirit of grace. Hebrews 10:29, how much more severely do you think a man deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified him, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? Grace in the world today is because the Spirit is released in the world today. And when we feel grace, we are experiencing the Spirit of grace. Number seven, he's also the Spirit of adoption. The Spirit of adoption. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the Spirit of adoption, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. Somebody was talking in a meeting one time about, just last year, talking about the real challenge that we face in our world today, in our culture and society today, with same-sex marriage issue. That it's demonic. It's not just about, well, don't offend somebody, you know, so don't talk about this. We shouldn't be talking about homosexuality and things like that in the church because we don't want to offend somebody. But the truth of the matter is, if we buy into this whole thing of same-sex marriage, then we have just distorted the message of God and his love for humanity. Because if we go back into buying into the same sex, that there's really no God-ordained order of the family, then even the figure of the father is distorted. To think that you can bring together two women and make a family just has just X'd out the father figure of the family. And if we then, like we read earlier, when we talked about Israel from the get-go in the book of the Judges, when they had a generation that came up after Joshua, and the generation didn't know God, it only took one generation to totally get God out of the picture. We can see how sensitive and tender it could be. Because if you pass a law or reverse legislation now that would allow same-sex marriage, then you have a generation comes up in that image where there is no father figure, then you've lost, or just you've seen God be erased from a generation, and it's only one generation away, because all it needs is that generation to get this distortion in their mind of who God is. It takes away God the Father and their image. And here it says, it's the Spirit that comes into us, that Spirit of adoption that allows us to come to a Father or to God and say, you are Abba Father, not judge, jury, and executioner like most people in the world have this image of God. But it brings us into this wonderful relationship where He is the Father. And the Spirit is at work to try to keep that in play. We have to be so sensitive, careful, strategic, and even aggressive. And not lay down because a few want to try to change things. My goodness, come on, are you kidding me? I mean, in the last, what? I'm 50. 30 years ago, 40 years ago, I'm running on the streets of Bird Road and 24th Street, 87th Avenue, the values that have changed in just my lifetime from when I was a kid, the way things have changed just in my lifetime. And when I try to tell my kids today, hold on to certain values, there's also an influence that's trying to say, no, don't be so old-fashioned, Alessi. Steve, don't be so old-fashioned. Are you kidding me? Don't be like that. Don't tell your kids not to do that or to believe that. Come on, keep them open-minded. Are you kidding me? That we face that kind of opposition, and it's not man-made. It's demonic. Because if that spirit is quenched in this world, whereby he is not the spirit of adoption. And we're not talking about people that don't know God. We're talking about in our church. Because it's sad that even here in an environment like this where we're like-minded people, I still have to be so careful at what I say for fear that somebody might get all jacked up and offended. And of all people, we should be the ones that rally around the truth of God's word. I don't care what this one thinks or that one thinks. I'm believing for what God thinks. Amen. And His word says this. His word says that. And that's what I'm going to hang my hat on.
Right.
I don't have to be offended by that. This isn't a place where we got to worry about political, you know, being politically correct. Politically correct shouldn't be held a standard in society. That's for politics. That's where politically correct was for politics. It's not for the church, and it shouldn't be for the workplace. But you can't hardly say things in the workplace anymore. Because you can get accused of certain things. And all you're trying to do is speak truth. You can't even speak the word. There was a guy that came to our church, and after I can't remember what it was we were talking about. But he says, I got to go back, and I have to tell my supervisor that I'm going to a church that is going to be doing this particular thing. And it had something to do. Oh, it was when we had the gentleman come in from the American Family. Was it the AFA, American Family Association? What was it?
Guy from Romania.
Guy from Romania who came. This guy that worked in our, that came to our church. What was it?
Liberty Council.
He had to go and tell his supervisor that he was in a meeting that was discussing things that we were talking about here in church. Because if the company found out that he was in a meeting like that without him telling them, there would be some consequences to it. And all he was at was at a church service where we were talking about things like standing up for the marriage amendment.
That's right.
Are you kidding me? All of that to squelch, even the spirit of adoption that's in the world today. He's also known as the spirit of glory. 1 Peter 4:14, if you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed. For the spirit of glory and of God rests on you. That word glory in the scriptures there means character. And 1 Peter is showing us that the Holy Spirit is the one who produces God-like character in the believer's life. So I have to have a relationship with the Spirit of God to build the character of God in me.
Yes.
So have you learned some things so far?
Yes.
Does it make sense?
Yes, it does.
Shows us how important it is to recognize the Holy Spirit as part of the Godhead in our walk and our relationship with God. Let's look at some of the divine works. Divine works. Things that God did, works that God did that show the Holy Spirit was also active. The first of which is going to be creation. Creation. Scripture demonstrates how the Lord creates, and through comparison, we can conclude that the Spirit was involved in the creation of the entire universe. Psalm 33, verse 6. It says, by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, their starry hosts by the breath of his mouth. Someone says, well, I don't see the word Holy Spirit or the name Holy Spirit there. Well, here it is. It's the word breath. Write this down in your notes. The word breath is the word ruach. And that word ruach is spirit. Capital S, spirit. Not small s, the spirit or the life or the light or the candle in a man that burns to show that he's alive. It is the spirit of God. So we read it this way. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, their starry hosts by the spirit of his mouth. So as God spoke these things into being, the spirit of God was evident. Here again in Genesis 1, 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the face of the deep. And here he is. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Hovering. Our author in our textbook talked a little bit about that hovering. But it seems to be that hovering would be similar to kind of like a microwave effect. I think our writer took exception to this, but I happen to believe this. This particular theory, it's like the chicken sitting on her eggs. She sits on it. She warms it so that life can come forth. And that's the image that we see with that word hovering. That it's there that you see the Spirit was in operation to prepare the earth for life again. You know, there is the understanding that there was a world at one time. Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2 seem to be separated by thousands, perhaps millions of years. There was a perfect world that was created in Genesis 1 because anything that God ever created would be perfect. It wouldn't be in a formless or void state. And it's there between chapter 1 and verse 1 and verse 2 that some have felt like there was this fall from Lucifer coming and falling to the earth. And it took place there, which now caused complete havoc and devastation on the planet. So then verse 2 is the beginning of the recreation. And it, so it shows that there is already life, but that life had to be birthed again. But it's at that creation or recreation. And the point here is that the Spirit of God was active in this creative work, taking something that was nothing and making it live, making it of substance. And what that says to us, if he was creative in the work with the world, then whatever we need life in, whatever we need created in our own world, in our own life, will be created through the Spirit of God. Job 26, verse 13, by his breath the skies became fair. Again, the word ruach there, or the word breath is the word ruach, meaning spirit. By his spirit, the skies became fair. Job 33:4, the Spirit of God has made me. The breath of the Almighty gives me life. There it is again, breath. The Spirit of the Almighty gives me life. So we see that the Spirit is active in creation. We also see that he's active in regeneration. And this regeneration speaks of the communication of a new life. That when we were born, we stepped into this recreation mode. Titus 3:5, he saved us through the washing of rebirth and the renewal by the Holy Spirit. So the Spirit is active in our regeneration. 2 Corinthians 3:6, he has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter or the law, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit, here it is, gives life. Yes. There is this regeneration effect to the Spirit operating in our world and in our life. Makes all things new. When we sing that song, you make all things new, we get all into that. Well, do you realize that the very Spirit of God is the one that gets busy in making all things new? Let me pull up here John chapter 3. I want to read what Jesus says. John chapter 3 and verse 5, reading out of the NIV here. Jesus answered, verse 5, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, he says, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. So that when we are born again, when we are regenerated, we are born into God through this work of the Spirit. Not only are we given license to through the work of Jesus on the cross, but now helping us start afresh, helping us start things new, is that of the Spirit. And notice Jesus uses the wind there or to try to describe a little bit of what the work of the Spirit is, that it's like the wind. And the wind blows in, and let's face it, the wind blows some trees pretty heavily, and you see the result of that. But then again, there are bigger, more mature trees that you don't see the wind affecting whatsoever. Sometimes of the strong wind, you see the effects of it. But then again, when there's a light wind, you don't see much effect of it at all. And that's what happens with rebirth and regeneration. Sometimes in the natural eye, you don't feel the change. And it's because it's not an outward change. It's an inward change. And so you may not feel the effects of the wind blowing, but God is still at work. God is still on your side trying to develop you into the person that God, he sees you as being. So he has the Spirit at work of regeneration. Then again, there's other experiences that go on in your life, and it so knocked you off your course that you're like, wow, where did that come from? And you learn from that experience. And like some of us have had to learn in the hog pen, you know, you got to go through some things to learn it and be out there alone from the Father because you've been running. And then when you finally come to yourself, you're like, wow, I'll never do that again. That's the same Holy Spirit at work, but it's like he comes up at you with a bat and just kind of pops you along the side of your head because you haven't realized the need to change, but he's going to get you to change.
Right.
Aren't you thankful that who you are today is not the same person you were 5 years ago? Amen. How much has changed in you? Amen. How much stronger are you today? How much more mature are you today? Amen. How much more developed are you today in God or even as a person? Man, I'm just thankful nobody wrote me off when I just came out of school or even when I was in my 30s. How far we have developed. Why? It's because of the work of the Spirit in our life. He's regenerating us. Do you know, even when I felt the call to the ministry, I tell you this story, but it was really, in the past I've told you this before about the calling. It was the Spirit of God who called me into the ministry. I went to a first year Bible school. It didn't go well. So I came home that second year and I was trying to do other things. That didn't go well either. But I got to the book of Acts and I started reading the book of Acts. And as I read through the book of Acts, the Spirit of the Lord got a hold of me there in that bedroom of my mom and dad's house. It's my little King James Version Bible that I had. And as I started into the whole Acts story, more and more hearing about the work of the Spirit, it was then that as a kid, I felt the call of God. And to where I was then, to where even I needed to get to graduate from school, the maturing that I needed to do was all the work of the Spirit to bring that all to play. So that's the work of the Spirit. He is that part of the Godhead that wants to develop us and regenerate us. And Jesus says you can't even get saved without him. Because you got to go through a baptism not only of water, but you got to go through a baptism of the Spirit if you're going to change. You know, it's like this. The baptism of water says, man, I'm going under this water to erase the old man. But the baptism of the Spirit introduces us to the new man.
Amen.
And if you've been baptized in water, that's beautiful. But have you been baptized in the Spirit? Have you been introduced to the new man? Do you have a picture of who God wants you to be and what God sees when he sees you? And then thirdly, we see that he is the resurrection. Here we're talking about divine works that are accredited to him. He is the resurrection. And this is the new life that our bodies will take on, similar to the reference of the bodily resurrection of Christ. But it's a new life that we take on here and in the world to come. So it says even of the resurrection, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you. Just what did that picture look like? Did you ever try to do that? What did that picture look like when the Spirit went into Jesus to raise him from the dead? What did that look like? What was that whole thing like? That here's the dead body of Christ, and now the Spirit goes in and takes the dead things and breathes life into that dead thing again to make it live again? How powerful was that, man? You know, there had to be. The reason there was a whole a boulder on the front of that thing was that because that was just a God stuff. You know, there was no hidden cameras. Nobody caught a glimpse of this thing. This was just a God thing. But wow, how cool that would have been to see all of that take place. How the Spirit could go into a dead body and bring it to life again. And he says, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. So the dead things that are in us can come to life again. because of the work of resurrection of the Spirit in our lives today. And lastly, let us see how the Holy Spirit was the author of divine prophecies. In the Scriptures, catch this, there are 3,800 occurrences where the statements like this are made. 3,800 of them. Statements like, the Spirit has entered into me. Statements like, Jehovah spoke unto Moses. Statements like, the Lord said to Isaiah, or the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, or the Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. 3,800 times when different statements occurred like that. There's many more examples of it. The point is, whenever there was a prophetic word that came to man, it was originated by the Holy Spirit. And Peter shows us that. It says, 2 Peter 1:21, for prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Every prophetic utterance came from the Holy Spirit. Pretty powerful, huh? All right, let me close with this. One more thing that we read out of our study book. From a prophetic standpoint, it talks about Deborah's wisdom. As a prophet, Deborah was a speaker for God, speaking as she was carried along or borne along or led along by the Spirit of God. Her prophetic gift qualified her to lead, judge, and rule a nation. This is a woman. Deborah was, in fact, the only judge who was recognized and accepted as a judge before winning any military victories or delivering God's people from their enemies. So many commentaries suppose the only work of the Spirit in the time of the judges was the production of a kind of divine ecstasy or enthusiasm. But we do not find that to be so in Deborah's case. I'm on page 37. She sat under a palm tree between Ramah and Bethel, probably about 15 miles north of Jerusalem. And the people came to her with their problems, disputes, and questions. They came because they recognized she was in touch with the Lord. She was married, and there's no indication that she neglected her former husband. But she found time for this ministry. The Spirit of God continually gave her wisdom to exhort the people and to comfort them, challenge them, and settle their differences. She needed no prompting to do this, no fleeces to encourage her face. Many considered her the most spiritual of all judges. Man, if that's what the Spirit of God could do with a woman like Deborah, then my prayer tonight is that that's exactly what He'll do for every one of you. You don't need a title. You don't need to have a title to make you a substantial person, an influential person. You need the Spirit of God. And may He lead you, direct you, and point you in the right direction and allow you to get connected with the right people. And may those that you work with, those that you live with, those that you minister with, be able to see something in you that draws them to you. And may you have the answers, the wisdom, and the direction that whatever it is they're needing, God will use you to minister to them with. If that's for you, just lift your hand right now and say, I'll take that. Father, that is true of every one of us in this room tonight. We'll take that. May your Spirit move in our lives. Holy Spirit, thank you that you are alive. Thank you that you're real. That you breathe even in our lives. Some of us need a fresh breath to just come on us, inspiring us, building us up, strengthening us. And we praise you for that. And we give you permission to move in our lives in such a way. In thy name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. God bless you. Next week we'll be talking about the Spirit as a person. Make sure you get to reading chapter 4 as you talk about the Spirit in the writing of the prophets. If you'd like this book, you're joining us in our class. This book is available. You can go right out to the table here and you can pick up that book. We also close our service on Wednesday. We give you an opportunity as our ushers come forward. If you'd like to go ahead and give of your offerings, your tithes and your offerings tonight, you can do so as our ushers are coming forward at this time and making those available for you. Perfect. If you were here this weekend, how many?